Thank you to Brain Canada and McGill University for inviting me here to speak at the Amazing Brain Science Talks. My name is Dr. Matthew Galati. I'm a brain injury survivor, a medical doctor, and the founder of a nonprofit organization called Brain Changes Initiative. And I'm so excited to be here with all of you today to share my story. When I was asked if I could do this talk, I remember asking how much time I'd have allotted to present. And when I was told there was just be 12 minutes, I felt like this was a sign that this was something that I had to do. And this is because 12 minutes was the estimated amount of time that it took to completely change my life forever. So at the time of my injury, I was a second-year medical student, and I just finished writing my first semester, second year medical school exams, and I was back home in Toronto visiting some friends and family for the weekend. And I originally had planned to leave to head back to my medical school in Windsor, about 4 hours from Toronto, on the Sunday night, but the weather conditions were so bad that I decided it was probably best if I leave on the Monday morning instead. Monday, January 28th, 2013. I'll never forget this day. This is the day that everything would change. So unfortunately, the weather was even worse. And I deliberated about whether I should leave the next day or prolong my return even longer, but I had to be back to med school for a mandatory small group session. So I had a passenger who was gonna be driving with me, a good friend named Phil, who was in the car and he was in a different program. And we started our drive back to Windsor. And the weather conditions were so bad that at about the halfway point in Woodstock, Ontario, there was a detour route off the highway. And it was about 12 minutes into this detour route where I would hit black ice, car would spin out of control, and I would collide with a tree. Either hit my head on the side of the tree or on the side of the car, and the rest is history. So that's a picture of the car. And as you could see, it was a very, very bad accident. So luckily Phil, you know, he suffered injuries himself. He had some rib fractures and he was in a frazzled state, but as you could see, the driver's side absorbed majority of the impact. So he was actually able to get out of the car and call an ambulance, and luckily he was able to do this, because if he wasn't, I don't know if I'd be here giving this talk today. Within 12 minutes, roughly, the fire department EMS showed up. They removed me from the car using the jaws of life, and I was transported to the nearest hospital, which was Woodstock Hospital. And that's a picture of me. And I had, my injuries were very bad. I had skull fractures. I damaged a facial nerve. So for months, I couldn't move one side of my face. It looked like I suffered a stroke. The nerve actually regrew a millimeter a day. I had multiple rib fractures. I collapsed both of my lungs. And most critically, I had a traumatic brain injury, a severe traumatic brain injury, and a bleed inside my brain, and I was knocked into a coma. And nobody could tell my family when I was going to emerge from this coma. It could have been minutes, it could have been hours, it could have been days, it could have been years. That's the unpredictability of the brain. So I awoke from the coma 3 days later, and I ripped out all of my IV lines and took out my intubation tube. I was very disoriented and confused. I also had expressive aphasia, so I couldn't articulate things the way I wanted to articulate them. I had poor memory and concentration, poor executive functioning, so my ability to plan and organize was impaired. I had limited mobility, decreased speed of processing, and most critically, I had very poor insight. I thought that I just had suffered a mild concussion, and I was going to be back to medical school relatively quickly, but the reality is that I was presenting very, very poorly, and my prognosis was poor, and medical providers were very guarded in any expectations they were giving my family about my potential return to my medical studies. So after spending some time in critical care and then subacute care, I was eventually admitted to Toronto Rehab Institute, where my inpatient rehab began. And luckily, I had a number of positive factors that would predict a good recovery. I was relatively young. I was 23 years old at the time of my injury. I was an avid athlete, and you guys just heard about the positive effects of exercise on the brain. And, you know, it's also important for recovery of the brain. I was a medical student, so I had a high pre-injury baseline in terms of my cognitive skills. I had a lot of connections already built up in my brain, and I had a very strong support network in my family and friends. And at Toronto Rehab, I was actually enrolled in a research study, which the goal of which was to intensify all of my therapies. So I was receiving double the physio, occupational therapy, speech-language pathology that all the other patients were receiving on the same unit in hopes that I'd make a better recovery and be able to return to my medical program. And also, as a part of this research study, I had to write a series of 4 neuropsychological evaluations, which tested all of my cognitive functions like memory and attention, speed of processing, etc. And it was clear from the first study that I wrote while I was still a patient at the end of my stay at Toronto Rehab that I was not going to be able to return to medicine. I still had a lot of impairments and difficulties that I had to overcome. So there were some recommendations from my inpatient allied healthcare team to my outpatient allied healthcare team about some things that I needed to work on, and I was discharged home. At home is where I came across this book that really became my Bible in the outpatient setting, a book called Spark, The Revolutionary New Science of Exercise and the Brain by John J. Rady. And this book starts off by talking about a school district on the outskirts of Chicago, and there's nothing remarkable about this school district. It's not like they put more money into the school district or the students were any smarter than in any other school district. But the one thing that was completely different was that they completely revolutionized their gym program such that all their students would exercise rigorously at the beginning of every day to prime the brain for learning. And the really amazing thing is after changing this gym program, these students scored number 1 in the world in science and number 6 in the world in math on international standardized testing. And then the book goes on to discuss all of the positive benefits that exercise has on the brain, and they're umpteen. And I should mention, by aerobic exercise, put very simply, I mean any exercise which elevates your heart rate and breathing. And to name a few of these positive benefits, aerobic exercise increases the flow of blood and oxygen to your brain. It increases the levels of hormones or chemicals that improve mental processing, like dopamine, serotonin, and norepinephrine. It reduces inflammation in the brain. It also promotes positive structural changes in the brain, so there are certain brain regions which actually grow in size with exercise. And aerobic exercise creates new brain cells through a process called neurogenesis. It was through Spark that I learned about this incredible new concept to me called neuroplasticity or brain plasticity, the ability of the brain to adapt, rewire, and change. And what neuroplasticity means is that with every experience, touch, feeling, physical sensation that we have, this stimulates thousands of neurons in our brain forming neural networks. And with repetition of any given task, new learning, or skill, our brain learns to trigger these same neural networks every time. And this is the way that conversion of short-term to long-term memory takes place, or learning for that matter. And a very simple way to put this is the 10,000 hour rule, which essentially states that if we apply 10,000 hours of our time to anything, we could become an expert at that very thing. So I took this information and I literally ran with it. I started structuring my days around aerobic exercise. I would wake up early in the morning and run 5 kilometers to create these new brain cells, and then I would go home and fill these new brain cells with meaningful information by stimulating my brain any way I could think of. And I really tried to pick a vast array of different types of cognitive activities to cover all of my bases. So, for example, I was reviewing medical school notes that I had missed to practice my memory and attention. I picked up the guitar to practice fine motor skills. I was writing in an agenda to practice my organizational and planning skills. And just 6 months after my motor vehicle accident, I returned to Toronto Rehab to write my 2nd neuropsychological evaluation. And there was a huge improvement. I scored in the top percentiles amongst both brain-injured patients and the standardized healthy subjects for the same age and education level. And I was fortunate enough to return to my medical studies within 8 months post-injury, and I had to rewrite one exam to prove to the deans that I was ready to be back. So I chose the hardest exam that I had passed from the year before. And it took a lot of hard work and studying, but my mark actually improved by 10% from the year before. So I was lucky enough to successfully complete my my medical school and then a family medicine residency, followed by a fellowship, so subspecialty training in something called integrative care, which is all about treating disease states at the root cause level. And in retrospect, this is really the way I healed my own brain of its injury. And I also began traveling around the world. And another reason why I mention these two things is because by putting my brain in such stimulating environments so soon after my injury, this in essence was incredible rehab for me and probably had an immense impact on my recovery. What am I doing now? I'm a family doctor. I have a clinic on the east end of Toronto. I also work at a rehab hospital as a hospitalist, and we treat a number of conditions, including traumatic brain injury, to help people recover. And I'm also the founder of a nonprofit organization called Brain Changes Initiative. And our mission at Brain Changes is to fund groundbreaking research to improve the standard of care for traumatic brain injury. And we also provide a lot of education, awareness, and support around lifestyle pillars of brain health. And that's a picture of me in an article that was just published by Toronto Life featuring my story and Brain Changes. And here are the six pillars of brain health that we're proponents of at Brain Changes. And we didn't have time to mention all of them today, but they were all a huge part of my recovery. And just to go over each of them very, very briefly, you've already heard about the first two. So aerobic exercise, which creates new brain cells, cognitive activity, which fills new brain cells with meaningful information, nutrition or brain healthy diet to provide your brain with the best possible nutrients to heal and recover, limiting harmful exposures to provide your brain with the best environment to heal and thrive. And by limiting harmful exposures, I'm talking about things like alcohol and smoking, sleep, which is important for memory consolidation and learning, and mindfulness meditation to filter out distractive thoughts about past or future so that we could be ultra focused on the present and structuring new healthy neural connections. So I started off this talk with how significant 12 minutes is and how this was the amount of time that it took to completely reroute my life. And as you could see, even these past 12 minutes really flew by. But a lot could be learned in this short amount of time. In these past 12 minutes, we introduced a life-changing concept, something called neuroplasticity, the brain's ability to adapt, rewire, and change. And I hope my story has demonstrated to you all today that the impossible is possible, and that these simple tools for changing the brain have resonated with you. 12 minutes can lay the foundation, but know that the road to success in any aspect of your life takes time, dedication, and reinforcement. So now I leave it up to you to build off of these past 12 minutes and choose where to dedicate your time and practice in order to make positive changes in your life. Speaking of brain changes, please scan the QR code and follow us on Instagram. Our website is brainchanges.org. We put out a lot of really, really vital information about how to live a brain healthy lifestyle. Thank you for listening to my talk.